suicide is preventable. In most cases, it is preventable. Because unlike popular myth, somebody spontaneously killed himself or herself, more than 90% of the people who decide to take their own life do it by thinking, and then moving on to deciding how to go about it, when to do it, and finally coming to that point where they actually go ahead and end their life. In fact, suicide is defined as a cry for help. It is a message to the whole world saying that, is there anybody out there who cares for me? Am I totally isolated from the rest of the world? Is everybody enjoying life and I'm the only one who's left out, without any direction, without anything to do? That is how a person starts, getting isolated. But even when the person gets isolated, it is amazing to know that a person who feels suicidal does not just walk in and commit suicide. People think that suicide is a cowardly act. People actually tell somebody who has attempted suicide and who's been rescued, they say, what sort of a coward are you? Why are you running away from problems? Everybody has got problems. You can't just escape like that. Can't you think of your mother or your so-and-so and this and that sort of thing? Why do you want to just take the easy way out? Now here I want to emphasize on one very important fact, and that is that it is not an easy way out. It's an extremely difficult way out. People who actually attempt suicide require a lot of courage. It takes immense courage. It takes more courage to take your own life than to kill somebody else. And that is the reason why, statistically, for every one person who commits suicide and dies, there are probably 5 or 10 people who have made an attempt but have not actually ended their life. And there are 50 to 100 people who are feeling suicidal, but somehow they are not able to take that one last step forward and go ahead and end their life. Now comes one of the most important questions. Why would a person want to end his or her life? Survival is inbuilt into us. Survival, in fact, is inbuilt into every living being. Even an animal or an insect who sees some danger or threat runs away from there. If I just take a little safety pin and come close to your hand, you'll pull away your hand. You don't even want to feel that, threat of a safety pin pricking you. Now, when there is so much, we plan ahead. As human beings, we are much more than animals in the sense I say, when I get old, who's going to take care of me? Will I have a house to stay? Will I have health facilities and that sort of thing? So when I'm willing to extend my life and follow up and do so many things, why do you think a person who is actually still got life ahead of him, why would such a person willingly, wantingly end his or her own life? The sequence goes something like this. When something goes wrong, I try to set it right. I lose a job, I take up another job and I move on. I have a relationship issue, I say, okay, it doesn't matter, let me see if I can rebuild some other relationship or something of that sort. So every time there is a setback, we work towards rebuilding ourselves and moving towards something better. But once in a while, what happens is, I find that there is no solution. I'm not getting a job, or I'm not getting that relationship, or I'm not getting something. So the first wicket that falls, the first thing which pulls a person down is a feeling of helplessness. I am now feeling helpless. I cannot do anything by myself. I cannot get help or support or something from somewhere else whereby I can undo this negative thing that is happening to me. Person doesn't commit suicide. Why? Because he lives on hope. Today I am not finding a solution. Maybe tomorrow something will improve. Maybe I just have to struggle it. Maybe I'm going through a bad phase. God will not let me down if I'm a believer. I have my son, once he grows up, he will look after me. things will never be as bad as this. So as long as there is some hope that somewhere in the future things will improve, the person continues to move on. If even that hope is gone, if somehow it dawns on the person that even in the long future things are not going to improve, they are only going to get worse, now my hope is dashed, even then I don't commit suicide. At that point of time, I start thinking that I would like to live life only one day at a time. I'll just exist in this world and I'll just move on. I'll do whatever is my duties and this and that, and then I'll push off. So I start living one day at a time, no ambition, nothing, no wants, just drudgery, and life goes on. The third wicket is when I start feeling worthless. What am I contributing by being alive? Who is happy by me being around over here? I'm not making anyone contented. I'm not serving any purpose by my very existence. I am worthless. That is the third and final wicket. When this happens, a person becomes suicidal. Now, all of us, you don't have to be a psychiatrist or a psychologist, all of us can somewhere or the other contribute towards prevention of suicide. Please become aware of people who are going through a bad time. Somebody who has attempted suicide earlier, somebody in whose social circles some other person has committed suicide, somebody who has had failure. Become aware that there's a possibility that this person can become suicidal. So outreach to such a person, give company, give hope, tell that person I'm there for you whatever little way I can. Then start looking for symptoms. You will notice that people who are suicidal lose interest in day-to-day life or in grooming. They don't want to talk about the future. They lose interest in their basic hobbies. They start giving away things and settling matters. And now these are very clear indicators that something is going wrong. Finally, you need to ask a person, things are very bad for you. You're going through such a horrible time. Do you get the feeling that you should end your life? Do you get a feeling that life is not worth living? Now, it takes a lot of courage by you to ask that question. People are scared. Am I giving him ideas by asking this question? No. You should ask. And once a person admits to you that, yes, I'm feeling suicidal or I'm getting these negative thoughts, 75% of his suicide risk has come down. Because, as I said, it's a cry for help. And the person says, here is a person who asked me, who is interested in me and who came to me and took interest in me. You may not be able to solve his problems, it doesn't matter, but you can share his desperation. Be there with that person. Try to give him a little hope. Explore anything and everything where something good may happen to him in the future. Most important, make him feel needed. You are needed in this world. Your mother is growing very old. Without you, she may not be able to face old age. Anything of that sort, you can work on those things. Once you start working on it, you will yourself find it becomes easier and easier. Let us all work towards finding out ways and means of reaching out to each other. We can never predict who will go to that stage where he becomes suicidal, but prevention is better than cure. So let's work on that.